Hi, I'm Bob Herbert. Welcome to Op-Ed.TV. You don't hear the name Hubert Humphrey much anymore. He was once a young mayor of Minneapolis and then a U.S. senator and then vice president under Lyndon Johnson. He was a champion of civil rights and a ruthless foe of anti-Semitism. In 1948, in one of the true acts of courage in American politics, he gave a heartfelt, full-throated speech on behalf of civil rights before the Democratic National Convention in Philadelphia. It was a time when, to say the least, civil rights was not popular. A new book, Into the Bright Sunshine, Young Hubert Humphrey and the Fight for Civil Rights, is a cultural biography of Humphrey that gives us a dramatic, compelling portrait of that important era in American history, an era that tells us a lot about the times in which we are living now. The author is Samuel G. Freedman, a Columbia University professor and former columnist for the New York Times, and he is my guest. Professor, welcome. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks so much for having me, Bob. It's a real honor to be with you.
First, the book is terrific. I mean, it's a we talked about it on the phone. It's a terrific book, and it's also a great read, and I think it's an important book. So I offer my congratulations on this. It looked like an awful lot of work.
8.5 years.
Oh, my goodness. So let's start with a brief overview, and maybe you can talk a little bit about the historical importance of Hubert Humphrey and why you wanted to write this book.
I felt that I was filling two gaps in writing this book. One was a biographical gap about Hubert Humphrey, in that your introduction was really superb, a great distillation of Humphrey's public life. But if people remember him at all these days, they remember him from the latter part of his career, when he was very discredited in liberal circles, which had been his political home, because of his support for the Vietnam War, because he got the Democratic nomination for president amid the police riot at the 1968 Democratic Convention.
In Chicago.
And because he was the establishment's candidate running against George McGovern, the peace candidate for the Democratic nomination in 1972. But the gap was that he had had this incredibly valiant earlier part of his political career when he was way out in front on civil rights. I mean, and I felt that that was something that people hardly knew, and if they knew it, they didn't credit it enough. And that was the biographical gap. The historical gap is that when we think about the civil rights movement, we tend to place its origins in the mid-1950s, with Thurgood Marshall winning Brown versus Board of Ed decision, outlawing school segregation in 1954, and Dr. King and Rosa Parks leading the Montgomery bus boycott in 1955. But there was an amazing civil rights movement in the 1940s, in a lot of ways really catalyzed by black GIs with their movement for what they call Double V, victory over fascism abroad and then Jim Crow at home. Jewish GIs had a very similar attitude about taking on anti-Semitism on the home front. And Hubert Humphrey was huge in that period of time. I mean, in the 40s, the movement is led, as it should be, by black Americans. It's Walter White of the NAACP, A. Philip Randolph of the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters, Mary McLeod Bethune. But there were few whites who were really significant in it. Eleanor Roosevelt, Henry Wallace, and maybe most important of all, Hubert Humphrey. So that was the historical gap to fill.
There's all the attention to World War II, which ends in 1945. And then the post-war period, people tend to view it as the 1950s and the booming economy and that sort of thing. And that era from the mid or end of 45 until 1950 really gets short shrift.
There was this period of time, I think it begins once it's evident the Allies are going to win World War II, but it continues into the first couple of post-war years before the Cold War turns the whole country a lot more suspicious and conservative politically. And in that moment, in the mid-40s, there's a real reckoning with what is America? Who are we? If we spent all this blood and treasure to defeat fascism and the forms of intolerance practiced by Imperial Japan as well, what are we going to do at home? Who are we? And that led to real reckoning on issues of racism, on issues of anti-Semitism, also anti-Catholic attitudes. And that was a period I was really drawn to exploring because it has gotten, comparatively speaking, so little attention.
So Humphrey was a small town kid. He grew up, I guess, in South Dakota.
Yes.
So he's out there in the Middle West. It's essentially an all-white environment. We know a lot about the Jim Crow South in that era, but what was the Midwest, and for that matter, the North like when it came to civil rights and also anti-Semitism, which also is very prominent in your book? It's not just about the civil rights of blacks.
Right. No, those are terrific questions. I mean, to quote the great philosopher George Clinton of P-Funk, Humphrey grows up in a very vanilla place, and he's a very vanilla person.
Right.
Dolan, South Dakota, population about 500, where he grows up is a little town set up by the railroad company just so farmers could ship in their livestock and grain to the Twin Cities. It's very homogeneous. It's white Protestant, people of Northern European, Scandinavian, and British Isles extraction. It's very conservative. Humphrey's father is very idealistic. He's the rare liberal Democrat in town. He's the very rare agnostic in town. And he's an important influence on Humphrey, of course. But the other thing that influences Humphrey and that makes him a New Dealer before there's a New Deal is that the Dakotas basically went into the Great Depression a decade before the rest of the country.
You're talking about the 20s now.
In the 20s, because crop prices fell dramatically for a variety of reasons I won't go into now. But that set off a cascade of people losing their businesses, losing their homes, banks failing. That's all happening in the 1920s. And for Humphrey, the lesson of that is you need activist government. You can't just depend on the local church to give charity. And you can't think that people fell into economic distress because they had bad values. So that's the first step. But what's the transformational, and to jump ahead and talk more about the upper Midwest, in places like the Dakotas, you had the double edge of populism. Populism in the person of people like William Jennings Bryan had admirable attitudes about economic inequality, breaking the power of monopolies, breaking the power of big banks. But it also had this underside. It was nativist, it was anti-Semitic, it was anti-Catholic, it was anti-black. And so it was a very limited ideology, very problematic ideology. And that was characteristic even of many liberals in the upper Midwest. And then when you go to Minneapolis, where Humphrey's going to have his public life, Minneapolis was a city where an overwhelming Protestant white majority lorded its power over the minority groups in town, over the blacks, over the Jews, over the Catholics, over the Native Americans, and cut them no quarter. And it was a place that even if it didn't have de facto segregation such as existed in the South, it was practically speaking every bit as bigoted. I'll just give you two examples on the subject of racism. When a black World War I veteran who was also a postal worker bought a home in 1931 in a middle-class Scandinavian Protestant neighborhood of Minneapolis, the people in that neighborhood surrounded his house. Thousands besieged the family's house night after night. And it was a celebration. You know, we see these postcards from lynchings in the South where everyone's wearing their Sunday best and they want to get their photo taken because it's like a holiday.
Yep.
Same thing happened in Minneapolis with that family in their home. And on the Jewish side, this almost sounds hilarious, but it gets to how pervasive anti-Semitism was. You couldn't even join AAA in Minneapolis if you were Jewish. I've read an account of a rabbi who tries to join, and they send him over to St. Paul, which was a majority Catholic city, which was much more tolerant as a result. And so you had, in Minneapolis in particular, what black folks sometimes call up South.
Right, exactly. That struck me, the AAA thing. Oh my goodness.
I think that Tom Friedman, who grew up in the Twin Cities, the great New York Times columnist, has even mentioned that from time to time in his columns. And I wondered if it was an urban legend, but it isn't.
But it's true.
It's true.
So before we get to Humphrey becoming the mayor of Minneapolis and of course, giving this legendary speech, he spent some time in the South. Can you talk a little bit about that and the influence that that had on him?
Absolutely. The year that makes Hubert Humphrey the person we recognize, Humphrey at his best, is the year he spends going to grad school at Louisiana State University in Baton Rouge, the 1939-1940 academic year. And he goes there as a standard issue New Dealer, which means he adores Franklin Roosevelt.
Right.
He sees politics really purely in terms of economic inequality and trying to rectify it. And I'm all in favor of that, but that point of view had real limitations. And he discovers other ways to approach liberal politics from his year in Baton Rouge, because for Humphrey, ideology has to come out of personal experience. His brain has to be turned on by his heart and his gut. And when he's in Baton Rouge for that year, number one, he lives in a Jim Crow society for the first time. And he passes through Baton Rouge's main black neighborhood called the Bottoms every day going to and from his home and the LSU campus. And he sees all the personal humiliations and degradations the black people are subjected to. And it offends something at his core. Mm-hmm. Second thing that happens is he makes Jewish friends for the first time. You wouldn't expect that in Baton Rouge, but his best friend on the debate team there is a Jewish guy from central Louisiana named Alvin Rubin, who, among other things, tells Humphrey about his five uncles who are trapped in Lithuania and will all be exterminated by the Nazis. And that sensitizes Humphrey during a period of isolationist sentiment in this country from both the political left and the right to the need to take a stand against evil, the terrible mortal risks of being a Jew in Europe, the effect of that on Jews in America. And the last thing is he studies for that whole year with an exiled anti-Nazi, part Jewish professor named Rudolf Eberle. Eberle teaches Humphrey things that you can hear Humphrey saying in his campaign speeches for years to come. And one of the things Eberle says that I think becomes a mission statement for Humphrey is one day he looks at the 12 students in his seminar and says, if we were in Germany, maybe two of you would stand up to the Nazis.
Oh my goodness.
Because Eberle had seen cowardice and complicity on the part of centrist and establishment conservatives in Germany. And he's warning Humphrey and challenging him against it. And so when Humphrey goes back to Minneapolis, ostensibly to start work on a PhD, but really to begin his public life, instead of thinking like, oh, wow, I'm so grateful I'm out of the benighted South and going back to the enlightened North, the opposite. He goes to the North now for the first time, seeing the pervasive bigotry that's been in Minneapolis all along.
Right. There was an assassination attempt against Humphrey while he was mayor. Talk a little bit about that.
Exactly. Well, Hubert Humphrey had run for mayor and narrowly lost in 1943. He's kind of a conventional candidate. In 1945, he runs explicitly as the candidate who's going to take on racism and anti-Semitism. Right. He really mobilizes the black and Jewish communities. And amazingly, since they only comprise 3% maybe of the city's population, he wins over enough other people, I think, especially returning veterans, young people, to get elected. And he starts moving forward on a law against employment discrimination, a law against housing discrimination. He forces the city to study its own patterns of bigotry.
This is a time when this sort of thing
was not happening. And to top it off, he brings in an eminent black sociology professor from the HBCU Fisk, Charles Johnson, to run that study.
Right.
And this antagonizes many elements of Minneapolis's, you know, bigoted right wing. And one follower of, you know, from that part of town decides to assassinate Humphrey. And after months of threatening letters and one previous attempt at the police short circuit, one night Humphrey's coming home about midnight from the rubber chicken circuit, and outside his house, as he's fiddling with the front door lock, three bullets whiz by him. And when the police investigate, the person, even though Humphrey doesn't press charges ultimately, the person who they arrest on other charges, who in my view is certainly the would-be assassin, is someone who was a follower of the right-wing extremist Gerald L.K. Smith, someone who had correspondence with the most racist member of the House of Representatives, John Rankin of Mississippi, someone
notorious, someone
who had correspondence with an anti-black, anti-Semitic group called the Columnists in Georgia, and he was the one who tried to kill Humphrey. So Humphrey almost gave up his life for this cause. But the really impressive thing is it didn't deter him at all. He just went right back on the move politically on behalf of the issues that mattered to him, as if no one had nearly killed him.
So now we get to 1948, and we've got the Democratic National Convention, and Harry Truman is president of the United States. He had become president after FDR died. And now in 48, there's going to be a presidential election. Mm-hmm. And so we have the convention. Talk a little bit, talk quite a bit maybe, about what was going on in the Democratic Party at that moment, what was happening in the country, and how did Humphrey come to play such a significant role? Right.
I should preface this by saying something that maybe a lot of your viewers won't really have known, which is that as exceptional a president as Franklin Roosevelt was on economic issues, he had cut what I consider literally a devil's bargain
with
the southern wing of his party, which was to allow segregation to go unimpeded in the South, to never address segregation in the party platform, in return for the southern states voting for him and the southern members of Congress moving forward on New Deal legislation.
To the point where things like Social Security would exclude agricultural workers, for example, or domestic workers, so you couldn't even get Social Security once.
That was 90% of employed black people in the South. And even when the programs weren't written with those carve-outs, states administered them. So programs like the WPA and the Civilian Conservation Corps and rural electrification were all implemented in the South in bigoted, racially unequal ways. So that's this moral inconsistency, this great hypocrisy within the New Deal coalition. And heading into the 1948 convention, that's the issue that's going to boil over, because everyone knows Harry Truman will be renominated. Most people expect he's going to lose.
Right.
But the battle is going to be whether the Democratic Party will finally endorse civil rights. Truman, who at points had moved boldly on civil rights, by now has retreated from his own program. And he decides he wants to do what FDR always did, which is appease the Jim Crow South and hope to get their votes. The segregationists from the South have declared that if there's word one about civil rights in this platform, we're going to run our own protest, our own candidate. It won't be a protest candidate. We're going to try to win so many states in the South that neither Truman nor Dewey wins, and the House of Representatives will choose the next president. A. Philip Randolph, the great civil rights leader, is outside the conventional, I mean literally on the front portico of the conventional in Philadelphia, leading protest marches saying that black young men will not register for the draft or serve in the Army if the Army remains segregated. And then this group of young liberals, including Hubert Humphrey, is moving towards a confrontation that Truman doesn't want over a civil rights plank. And because of Humphrey's great eloquence as a speaker, he's going to be the person who's going to have to make this speech to the whole convention. He's going to have to persuade a majority of the delegates, and keep in mind that of 1,500 delegates, including alternates, only 17 are African American. So there's not a black voting bloc for civil rights in the convention. He's going to have to persuade a bunch of white men to vote for a civil rights plank, even though Truman doesn't want it, and even though the Southerners are saying they'll walk out and try to cost Truman the election. And that's the drama of what happens in Philadelphia that week in July 1948.
It doesn't sound like, from your book, Humphrey's all that happy about having to deliver this speech, by the way.
Right.
He also had a reputation for going on too long.
Right.
You know, he maybe he loved the sound of his own voice a little bit too much or whatever. But he's on time constraints when he has to give this speech. So talk about what he did and how he did.
Well, both of the things you say are true. I mean, Humphrey was on a mission for civil rights, but he really, in terms of the convention, didn't know if it was a suicide mission.
Right.
Truman's people at the convention said to him explicitly, if you give that speech, your career is over. And so he's...
And he's ambitious.
And he's ambitious. He wants to rise. He's this sort of comet, you know, ascending into the political firmament at this point. And this might be the end of it. One of the really important things that happens that week is he gets a letter from his wife, Muriel, who's a great political advisor of him, kind of, I think, putting some steel in his backbone, because she happens to talk about going to look for a a resort where the family can go for a week of vacation and finding out it has anti-Semitic and anti-black covenants in it, and telling Humphrey, we can't stay there. This isn't our politics. This isn't our values. Humphrey gets that letter the morning he's going to give the speech to the convention. And I think that's not just coincidental.
Right.
But the other important thing Muriel had once said to him is, because of the way he would go on and on in his speeches, and she says a couple months before the convention, Hubert, a speech need not be eternal to be immortal.
It's a wonderful line.
It's a great line, and it's so true. And convention rules limit him to 10 minutes, which is a real benefit to him.
Right.
So in that 10 minutes, he makes the moral argument about we can't have the hypocrisy within the liberal movement of accepting Jim Crow. He makes a Cold War argument that if we're going to say to these decolonizing nations in the black and brown parts of the globe, choose Western democracy over Marxist-Leninism, how can we say that if Western democracy accepts segregation? He appeals to people by saying, this is just Harry Truman's own civil rights program we're asking you to support, which is true.
Right.
And then he has the two...
This is the program that Truman had actually introduced and then backed away from.
Right. He tiptoed back from his own program.
Right.
Because this platform plank doesn't just in fuzzy, vague terms say we endorse civil rights. It says explicitly desegregate the military, outlaw lynching, outlaw the poll tax, and it guarantees the personal safety from physical retaliation, not only on the basis of race, but also religion and national origin. Mm-hmm. So this is a big deal of a plank, not only for American blacks, but for Jews, Catholics, Mexican Americans, Asian Americans. And he's selling this partly with his own eloquence, not only the pragmatic and moral arguments I laid down before, but two great phrases from the speech.
To those who say that we are rushing this issue of civil rights, I say to them, we are 172 years late. To those who say that this civil rights program is an infringement on states' rights, I say this, the time has arrived in America for the Democratic Party to get out of the shadows of states' rights and to walk forthrightly into the bright sunshine of human rights.
This platform plank on civil rights prevails because of Humphrey's speech.
It prevails. Humphrey's speech, some important support, not only from the liberal wing of the party, but from some big city Democratic bosses.
Which I thought was interesting, including our guy here in New York City in the Bronx.
I know, Ed Flynn in the Bronx and David Lawrence in Pittsburgh, Jacob Arvey in Chicago. But these were machine guys who could count votes. And they realized that because of the Great Migration, they had a growing black constituency in their cities and their states. And if the Democrats didn't offer anything meaningful to black voters, they'd continue to vote in homage to Lincoln, as they had for decades for the Republican Party.
They didn't really care that much about civil rights, but they did care about votes.
Exactly. They cared about votes. And so they came to Humphrey's aid, and it put him over the top with the civil rights plank being carried. The Dixiecrats walked out. But then Harry Truman had no choice but to run as a civil rights candidate. And that has immediate consequences. 2 weeks after the convention, he desegregates the armed forces and desegregates the federal workforce. The weekend before the election, he becomes the first major party candidate to give a presidential campaign speech in Harlem.
Wow.
And the reason he wins, and Bob, is the one and only reason he wins his upset over Tom Dewey, is a surge of black voters in key swing states.
Isn't that something?
Harry Truman does better with black voters than FDR ever did, and in some ways he deserved to do better.
Right, I agree. You mentioned Humphrey's wife, Muriel. Talk about the importance of Muriel to Hubert Humphrey.
Muriel and Hubert Humphrey had a really ahead of its time companionate marriage. She had great political instincts. She was an advisor he always went to pick her brain. And what she told him about his overlong speeches is emblematic of her practical sense of what worked and what didn't. And the letter she wrote about the resort they wouldn't go to tells you what her own moral fiber was like. So like Lady Bird Johnson, she got mischaracterized and caricatured as just the doting political wife, but both of them were whip smart.
Which is sort of, that's how I saw her back in the days. And that's the way she seemed, the right. doting wife standing off to the side, you know, and nobody's really paying attention to her.
Well, you know,
her.
The image was packaged that way with her and with Lady Bird, because the idea is if you actually show these are smart women who their husbands rely upon, either it'll make the husband look like he's henpecked.
Oh my God.
You know, right? I mean, you know, we've lived with that for so long, unfortunately.
Right. It was considered normal at the time.
Right. So you had to make her just look like someone, you know, with an apron and, you know, kitchen duty and wiping kids' runny noses
in order
to make her politically palatable.
Well, it's a great book. It's called Into the Bright Sunshine. The author is Samuel G. Freedman. Sam, thank you so much for being with us. I really appreciate it.
Well, Bob, I really appreciate being with you.
And viewers, thank you for watching, and I'll see you again next time.